On this week's show, Tesla's VP of Investor Relations sets an analyst straight on Model 3 battery costs and specifications, Volvo launches a new Drive Me trial in central London, and Nissan commits to making lower-priced electric cars alongside longer-range ones. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, April 29th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and we're here thanks to the wonderful donations of our Patreon patrons. So far, we're raising close to $1,000 per month, which not only helps us keep the site up and running, but also ensures there's not a single ad on our site or in our YouTube stream. And frankly, that's the way we like it. We start today's show with news of the highly anticipated, super hyped Tesla Model 3, namely information pertaining to its battery pack and vehicle construction. What's more, this morsel of information doesn't come from the usual source, Tesla CEO Elon Musk, but rather Tesla's Vice President of Investor Relations, Jeff Evanson. As we explained midweek, Evanson called into a Q&A session following a UBS analyst call with former GM EV expert John Barisa and industry analyst Colin Langan, who predicted that Tesla's mass market $35,000 sedan wouldn't make the California automaker a profit due to the high battery and construction costs. The analysis was based on conjecture and best guesses for Model 3 technical specifications, and thus, said Evanson, didn't correctly represent two factory variable costs, or FVC for short. Setting the record straight, Evanson said that Tesla's entry-level Model 3 would come with a battery pack less than 60 kilowatt hours in size and will make use of aluminium plus other materials for its construction. These two facts should reduce total build costs for the car, which has already secured more than 400,000 pre-reservation deposits and won't even enter production until late next year. Will it turn a profit? Well, Tesla seems to think so, but analysts have yet to be convinced. What they might be convinced of, however, is the continuing upward tick in range of Tesla's high-end luxury Model S electric sedan, thanks to the news this week that the US EPA has now approved range estimates for the recently refreshed Tesla Model S 90D. As detailed on Monday, the new range estimate for the dual-motor 90kWh Model S, but not the high-end performance variant, sits at 294 miles on the combined EPA test cycle. On the highway test cycle, however, that figure is actually 303 miles, making the current Model S 90D the first mass-produced electric car to top the 300-mile barrier. Of course, there are some caveats here, namely that the 303 EPA rating comes with some very specific circumstances, that you drive at a fairly constant speed on the highway with few hills, sudden acceleration, or bad weather. Given modern EPA tests are far more accurate at predicting real-world range than they used to be, however, we think those with a light right foot might be able to push that range far higher in perfect conditions, while those with a lead foot should expect to get less far per charge. Still, if you're planning to make a long-distance trip on a Model S on a regular basis, it pays to know that the Model S 90D is the one you should buy. As that last story categorically proves, no other electric automaker is currently coming anywhere close to the range offered by a Tesla car. But late last week, Japanese automaker Nissan launched a very cheeky attack on the amount of time customers will likely have to wait to get their hands on a Tesla Model 3. In an ad that appeared in various print publications as well as online, Nissan cheekily asked, "Why wait when you can drive an all-electric Leaf right now?" Highlighting its $4,000 cashback deal that's currently being offered on the popular electric hatchback, it suggested that those who paid the $1,000 refundable deposit in order to stand in line to eventually order a Tesla Model 3 should rethink their priorities. As various sites note, Nissan ads certainly makes a valid point. Buying a Nissan Leaf electric car, or indeed any other electric car, will get you off fossil fuels today. And unless you're one of the very lucky few to be at the head of the Model 3 queue, it'll probably put you in an electric car 1 to 2 years before your Model 3 rolls off the production line. But here's the thing. The current generation Leaf, however good, just can't compete with Model 3 in terms of claimed range or price. And while we think people should make the switch to electric sooner rather than later, we can't help but think Nissan's ad is, well, a bit of an own goal and perhaps should have been saved for the next generation Nissan Leaf, which we think will probably compete far more effectively against Model 3 based on the various rumours we've heard thus far concerning price and range. And we sincerely mean that. In a few years, we're hopeful that we'll see 200 plus miles similarly priced electric cars from Tesla, Nissan, GM, Hyundai and others. And what a wonderful world we'll be living in by that point, because there's nothing like some healthy competition to drive innovation, not just one company. I can't wait. We're off to Germany now, where the German federal government this week finally approved its first ever electric car incentive program. Worth an estimated 1.2 billion euro, $1.4 billion, the plug-in car incentive program will help an estimated 400,000 Germans receive a 4,000 euro discount of the sticker price of a new electric car, or 3,000 euro off the sticker price of a plug-in hybrid car. But what makes this program special isn't the 60,000 euro cut-off price, after which incentives won't be available, meaning luxury cars like the Tesla Model S, Model X, and high-end plug-in hybrids like the BMW i8 or Mercedes-Benz S-Class plug-in hybrid won't be eligible for a discount. It's the fact that rather than fund the scheme on its own, the German government is asking the auto industry to pay half of the incentive costs itself. Why? Well, historically, Germany has argued that incentives only benefit automakers, primarily because automakers tend to put up their sticker prices in order to make extra money off the incentive. But by asking automakers to pony up half of the discounts offered, it ensures that the incentive program encourages automakers to continually drive down the cost of plug-in cars and ensures its citizens can benefit too. There's also a new investment in charging points in the country, as well as commitment from the German government to buy plug-in cars for fleet use. So here's to a cleaner, more electrified nation in the near future. Staying in Europe, our next story focuses on the UK, where Swedish automaker Volvo announced this week that London will be home to its latest chapter in the Drive Me autonomous vehicle project. As anyone who's driven in London will tell you, and I actually learned to drive in the centre of the city, piloting an automobile in the UK's capital is a brutal assault on the senses. Aside from all of those tiny side streets, congested city main streets, and lemming-like tourists, there are those big double-decker buses, pushy taxi drivers, and death-wish motorcycle couriers. Which is probably why London makes the perfect place for Volvo to prove its autonomous drive technology has what it takes to be used by everyday people in everyday situations without any accidents, injuries, or mishaps. Selecting real families for the trial, which will expand in 2018 after a soft start in 2017, Volvo will send up to 100 XC90 plug-in hybrids fitted with Volvo's autonomous drive technology out onto the roads to see how the technology fares. And unlike other pilot projects, this one involves everyday drivers, not specially trained engineers. We'll be keeping our eyes on this one, so we'll let you know how the project progresses as time passes. Switching gears now, our next story is about the latest chapter in the ongoing Volkswagen Dieselgate scandal. And while some viewers are getting annoyed with our covering this story on our show, we think it's important because Dieselgate is the antithesis of our editorial remit to bring you the latest news in cleaner, greener, safer and smarter transportation. Anyway, this week we learned that Volkswagen CEO Matthias Müller personally telephoned the President of the United States of America, firstly to apologise for the Dieselgate scandal and secondly to try and, well, essentially beg for mercy. The reason? The ever-increasing bill that Volkswagen is facing as a consequence of the Dieselgate scandal, one which could see Volkswagen sell off some of its assets and lay off staff in order to be able to afford the billions of dollars of fines it now faces. Noting that he hoped Volkswagen could continue to provide employment to all of its US employees post-Dieselgate, Müller doesn't appear to have actually asked the president for time off for good behaviour, but he certainly took time to note what a negative impact the loss of jobs would have on the US economy should Volkswagen's fines be impossible to pay and it has to sell off assets and lay off staff. It's a little like the well-known fact that a guilty plea usually gets you a more lenient sentence in prison. But in this particular case, we suspect Müller's presidential telephone call will be too little, too late. Essentially, if you did do the crime and admit it, you have to do the time. I just hope that the US federal government is ready to step in to help any Volkswagen workers displaced by cutbacks as a consequence of this, because for most of Volkswagen staff, they haven't done a single thing wrong. Watch this space. Volkswagen may be worrying about making ends meet in order to pay all those fines for cheating in emissions tests, something it really does deserve. But elsewhere in the automotive industry, we've been discussing an affordability of a different sort this week, namely how affordable electric cars really are. That's because while cars like the Nissan Leaf, Tesla Model S, and upcoming Tesla Model 3 and Chevrolet Bolt are great ways to dump the pump for good, they're still not really very affordable for everyone. Even at $35,000 before incentives, the Tesla Model 3 will be way too expensive for many families around the world. Which is why Renault-Nissan CEO Carlos Ghosn reaffirmed the Nissan goal of producing more affordable electric cars this week, initially for the Chinese market. In an interview with Bloomberg, Ghosn reiterated the need for the Renault-Nissan alliance to develop both high-spec long-range electric cars like the next-generation Nissan Leaf, as well as lower-spec small-range cars for use by those who just couldn't afford a more expensive model. And while I've personally been talking to many readers this week who religiously say that EVs need to have at least 200 miles to be useful, I've got to agree with Ghosn. For many low-income families, an affordable 100-mile electric car would not only revolutionise their daily lives, but also save them a lot of money too. The challenge? Producing an electric car that can compete on price with entry-level vehicles like the Nissan Versa or Chevy Spark, with enough power to keep up with traffic, while also retaining a real-world 100 miles of range. I'm hopeful someone will figure it out soon, though, because all these long-range $30,000 cars have to drop the price of batteries for lesser-spec models too. But someone who doesn't have to worry about the price of cars is fictional spy James Bond, if only because Her Majesty is one fitting the bill for these high-tech, tricked-out rides. Traditionally, with the exception of that BMW 7 Series that could be driven remotely, James Bond has favoured gas-guzzling Aston Martin sports cars. But this week we learned that Aston Martin may be giving James Bond a new electric car to play with. We're gleaming this from a new interview aired at the end of last week with Andy Palmer, boss of Aston Martin and former Nissan executive known for his love of electric cars, telling CNBC that electric cars were almost as inevitable as death and taxes. Palmer said that the phenomenal acceleration, instant torque, and zero lag would be perfect for the Secret Service agent on his next big adventure. While he did hint that Bond may find himself transitioning to full electric via, say, a plug-in hybrid, Palmer seemed convinced that Aston Martin would be giving 007 a fully plug-in car to play with at some point in the near future. I can't wait. And finally, if we're talking about high-tech gadgets and James Bond cars, there's perhaps no car quite so worthy in real life than the Tesla Model S or Model X, thanks in part to the autopilot hardware included as standard on each and every example made since October 2014. Well, this week, a video surfaced showing the wonderful union of the Amazon Echo and the Tesla Autopilot API, with a little matchmaking help from special third-party library called Tesla Golang, which makes it possible for you to tell your Amazon Echo to pull your Tesla out of the garage and meet you by the door, just using your voice. Okay, so this isn't the first time we've seen a voice-activated Tesla video, but this one is super cool and, unlike Apple's Siri implementation, seems a whole lot more personable and reliable. I really want one. I really do. Sadly, I can't afford a Tesla Model S or even a Tesla Model 3 right now, but I do at least get to play with my rock-controlled Roomba. That's actually more within my price range and is super handy because I don't have to vacuum the house anymore. Seriously, it's awesome. As you might have guessed, that's your lot for this week, but I'll be back next week at the usual time with another episode of 10. And in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolved.com. You can catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolved or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please do consider keeping us independent and impartial by supporting us at our Patreon crowdfunding campaign over at patreon.com/transportevolved. We've got a few days until the end of the month, and it would be super great to get us to that $1,000 per month mark by then. At the moment, we're only 27 bucks short. As I said before, Patreon is our only source of income and, aside from the great work put in by our wonderful volunteers, is the only way we can actually grow our site. Right now, we're trying to raise about $7,500 in funds to buy a new editing machine that will mean we can make more videos with higher quality than we currently can manage, and faster too. So go on, help us out. As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including Hyundai's plans to bring a 200-mile SUV to market for 2018, a hotel that will lend you a Tesla Model S for your stay, Samsung SDI pulls out of the fuel cell business, and how some Tesla fans aren't really helping Tesla deal with its Model X quality control issues very effectively. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.